Welcome everyone, and thank you by watching this webinar hosted by Toradex entitled Introduction to Embedded Linux Security. My name is Denis Shimizu, and I am Technical Marketing Engineer at Toradex. First, let me introduce you to your main presenter for the day. Sergio Prado is the Torizon Core Team Lead here at Toradex. Sergio has an extensive record working with embedded software. He's very active on the open software community, providing significant contributions to projects such as Build Your Root and the Linux kernel. He also has a great expertise working projects that require security by design, such as payment system. We are really happy by having Sergio with us today, sharing his knowledge. Well, before diving into the webinar, let me cover a few organization points. First, very important, please use the chat window of the webinar tool if you have any technical issue and wish to let us know. At the end, we will also do an interactive question and answer session. However, if you have any questions at any time, you can type in the window and we will pick up some of them in the end. So there is a chat window and you can put your questions there. The webinar will be recorded and made available for on-demand viewing. So with this, let's get started. A very brief overview about Toradex and what we do. Toradex is focusing on making embedded computing easy to use to provide you simple access to the latest technology for your product development. We are doing this by providing highly reliable ARM system models, including software and support. We are striving to offer the lowest cost of ownership to you. Lowest cost of ownership means not just the model price, but we also consider things like your development part, time to market, long-term maintenance, and so on. We are proud of being able to have industry-leading support, including a very active community and a developer page with articles that are updated daily with about 800 articles. And as you can see, we have offices around the world with local support and warehouse. I'd like to explain a little bit our focus application. Our target markets are industrial automation, healthcare, laboratory, medical, test and measurement, retail and ticketing, transportation, and smart city. Typical projects that Toradex covers are customers with volumes requirements of a few hundreds to a few tens of thousands products per year. Here's a short overview of our products. We have three SOM families. Inside these families, the models are incompatible. So you can scale from IMX6 over IMX7 to IMX8. For these families of products, I would like to highlight Verdi. Verdi family is a recent addition to the Toradex portfolio. It was launched a few months ago. Like the other family of products, Verdi is pin compatible, is scalable. It features Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, simple or advanced power management. It has security features in hardware such as HAB, high assurance boot. Sergio will explain a little bit more further. Cryptographic acceleration engine and so on. The total dissipation power is up to 5 watts, and Toradex offers a long-term availability of 10 years for this product. We are also provide production quality software with these models, including reference images for the Yocto project. Torizon is a brand new offering from Toradex. It's an open source and easy to use industrial Linux platform. It's based on open software, so you can have no lock-in, and you can even rebuild it to fit your needs. Toradex comes with an OTA client to enable simple, safe, and secure software updates. Security is another focus of Toradex. Toradex provides frequent updates of Toradex. Toradex also allows simple access to hardware security features that make it easy for you to develop a secure device. There's a flavor available with real-time option. Toradex utilizes Docker for software containerization, which provides a vast software ecosystem. And now it's time to Sergio start his presentation. Sergio, please take over.
Thanks a lot, Dennis, for the introduction. And hello all. I hope you enjoyed this presentation. Our objective here is to talk a little bit about embedded using or improving the security of embedded Linux systems. as we're going to see in this presentation, security is really about managing risks, right? So you have to identify all the threats in your system. You have to identify the costs to mitigate that threat. And that we're going to talk a little bit about in the introduction of this webinar. And after that, I'm going to focus on the technical part of the presentation. I'm going to talk a lot about all the techniques that we have to improve the security on an embedded Linux systems. We're going to cover from boot, secure boot, to encryption, to capabilities, to techniques to improve the security of applications in C, C++, like fuzzing, runtime protections. We're going to talk a little bit about containerization to improve security, trusted execution environment. So it's a lot of technical content in this presentation. I hope you enjoy it. And in the end of the presentation, we're going to have some minutes of questions and answers. So let's start. Let's start a little bit with the introduction on the security. What is security on a computer system? Security is the protection of the system and its data, right? When you think about an embedded system, an embedded device, we have to protect the hardware. We don't only have software, right, to protect, we have hardware also to protect, because sometimes what we call in the security field the threat agent, he or she has access to the device. He could be a threat to your assets inside the device. As I already said, security is really about managing risks of your product. So let me talk a little bit about some concepts, because I'm going to use this concept during the presentation. First, we have owners. Owners are those who are somehow benefits from the product. So, for example, the manufacturer of the product is one of the owners. The user of the product or the company that's using the products are one of the owners. So those that are interested in the assets inside the device is the owner of the device. As is anything that has some value, could be data, could be code, could be the value that that device brings to someone, right? So that's the asset. And the security is really about you worrying about someone threatening your asset, someone like copying your code, or someone copying your data, or someone using your device to do something that you don't want the device to do. So threat is really that, something that is acting against an asset that in a way that could harm the device. And we have threat actors. Threat actors, I really don't like to say hackers when you talk about that bad person that is threatening something, the security of something. I think hacker is something very, very different from that. So in this presentation, I'm going to talk about threat actor. So a threat actor is someone or something that could cause harm to your system. For this, the threat actor will explore an attack vector or an attack surface. An attack vector basically is some input of your device. Could be an external input or an internal input. For example, if your device has an internet port, the internet port is an attack vector that an attacker could exploit that interface to try to gain access to your system. So every external port is a possible attack vector, USB port, everything that has an input to the system could be an attack vector, a file. So anything that could be an input to the system is an attack vector. And if you have vulnerabilities in an attack vector, a threat actor could exploit these vulnerabilities to attack and harm your system. I really like this image because it shows very clear that we have here a kind of cat and mouse game, right? Here at the bottom, we have the assets. That's the real reason we are protecting the system, the assets. We have threat agents trying to, for some reason, harm your assets. So a threat agent will use attack vectors to exploit vulnerabilities that will lead to risks to your assets. In the other end, we have owners of the products, could be the final user, could be the manufacturer. The owner is very worried about the risks of someone harming or accessing his assets. So an owner wants to minimize risks, right? So for that, he will try to come up with countermeasures or mitigations to decrease the amount of risks to the assets that they want to protect. So it's really kind of, as I said, a cat and mouse game, because the owners want to mitigate risks and the threat agents want to exploit or explore the vulnerabilities to access the assets of the systems. So it's really, as I say, a cat and mouse game. Who does the more effort on the system, who invests more money on trying to develop countermeasures or attack the system, is going to win. So this is really what security is about, minimizing risks of assets being compromised. And there is a process called threat modeling that could help us as a product development team to improve the security, minimizing the risks of the assets being compromised. So it's basically a risk assessment process where you identify all of the risks to your assets and how you could mitigate these risks. The result of the threat modeling is a threat model of your product. And I'm gonna show in a few slides a little bit what could be a threat model of your product. So this diagram is kind of how threat modeling works. The first thing you do is identify your assets. What do you want to protect, right? Could be your code inside the flash, could be the data inside somewhere else, could be what brings value to our product. This is an asset that you want to protect. You're gonna have to identify threats to the assets. So we're gonna have to take a look at your product, identify all of the attack vectors or the attack surface of your product, and what are the threats to this attack surface. And then the idea is identify the threats and the risks to the assets to mitigate them. This is the process that we call threat modeling. The result is the threat model of our system. And there are methodologies to do this, right? Unfortunately, at least I don't know a methodology that is focused on embedded system to do threat modeling on an embedded system. So usually when a company that develops an embedded system uses a methodology, for example, that a web application would use to create a threat model of the system. I'm gonna show here, just to give a simple example, I'm gonna show here the methodology that Microsoft created. I think it's kind of simple methodology to understand. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about it. And then after that, we're gonna go to the technical side of the presentation. So Microsoft developed this methodology called Stride and Dread. It's two different methodologies. The Stride methodology, the objective of the Stride methodology, it's to help you identify all of the threats in your system. So Stride stands for spoofing, tampering, repudiation, information disclosure, denial of service, elevation of privilege. Six different kinds of threats that your device could have, right? And here we have the security property of that threat. So spoofing is related to authentication. right? So if you don't have authentication, someone else could assume, could represent someone that he couldn't in your system. Like you have a web page in your system that don't provide authentication. So anyone can access that web page and reconfigure the device, right? This is a problem of spoofing. Another example, tampering. Tampering is related to integrity. So, for example, anyone could access your device and change the code inside the device, or change the data, change the configuration for some way, like doing an SSH that don't have authentication, and like changing a binary inside and making it run your own code. So it's tampering the device. That's another example. So the idea of the stride is really to help the company to identify all of the threads in his product, in his device. And the other methodology is the thread. That as soon as you get all of the threads, what you're going to have to do, rank them, identify the threads that will have the most impact in the system. And the thread methodology is a methodology to help you rank the threads. Thread stands for damage. So how much damage that thread could cause to your system, high, medium, or low. How easy it is to reproduce that thread. How exploitable it is, how many users could be affected, and how easy it is to discover that vulnerability. So you rank, as you can see, we have from 1 to 3. So the minimal value here would be 5, and the maximum value, all 3, would be 15. So you would have a list of all of the threads that you already identified, and you have a rank of the most important to the least important. That you, of course, it's a simple vision, because to get here, it's a lot of work, right? You have to write and design your system, break it down a lot to get to all of the threads, and after that, rank the threads. But that would be a result of the thread modeling. You have a list of all of the threads in your system. You rank, we have a rank of them. So based, here is just an example, okay? Because we have another methodologies to rank the threads. This is just an example. So if you use the thread example, you would have here a score from 5 to 15. And you would organize from the most important, have the higher score, to the least important. And you have to define a mitigation to that threat. What you should do to prevent or minimize, because most of the times, or sometimes, you can just prevent that threat from happening, but you can make it harder to happen, right? For example, you want a threat actor to not have access to your code. You could, for example, take your flash memory and put an epox inside the flash memory, so the threat actor can't like open the device and flash memory there, extract the flash memory. So you would make the life of the thread agent more difficult, right? But he could use tools to remove the epoxy and then have access to the flash memory. And then you could think, okay, so now I'm gonna add another layer of security. Let's encrypt the code. So as we can, we're gonna see here, and we're gonna start now to when you design a product with the security in mind, what you have to do is add layer on top of layer to make it harder and harder and harder for the system to be compromised. Just one solution most of the times doesn't help. You have to think about develop a lot of layers, because if an attacker could pass one layer, he's going to have to pass the other layer, and it's going to be more even more difficult for him. And of course, as I said, at some time he want just to stop the attack, because it doesn't make more sense for him, because it's taking too much time or too much money to attack the system. It's really, as I said in the beginning of the presentation, a balance, right, between the value of what you want to protect and the cost to protect this value. Okay, I think that's it for the introduction to the talk security. Of course, we could have a presentation only focused on that planning process, right, when you think about the security of the product. But our focus here is really the technical side. So now I'm going to talk about a lot of countermeasures or mitigations to improve the security of an embedded Linux system. And let's start talking about secure boot, because probably one of the main assets of an embedded device is the code that is running in the device. And if you want to protect the integrity and the authenticity of the code, you're gonna probably have to implement a secure boot system, right? A secure boot system will guarantee that what is running the device, it is what you plan to run the device. It's what you tested. So you will be sure that you don't have, for example, any malware or botnet or anything running inside the device. You can't have with a secure boot, with a secure boot implemented in the right way. Of course, and as we're going to see here in this presentation, there are trade-offs. There are costs to any mitigation that we implement in the system. There are costs. Sometimes the cost is very low, but sometimes the cost is very high, and you have to evaluate if the costs, if you're willing to have these costs to implement this mitigation. So for example, for a secure boot, what could be the costs? You're gonna have to worry about key management and provisioning of the keys. That's something that you're gonna have to have in mind. It could impact the boot time, right? Because there is going to be a lot of checks during the boot. And of course, there is more thing to do at boot time. The boot time would be higher, and you're gonna have to evaluate how much higher is that, depends on a lot of things, and if that's a good or bad thing for your system. It could make harder to develop on the device, that's another trade-off. You could, for example, work around on this, but you're gonna have to think about it. How does a secure boot work? Everything is based on verification of digital signatures. So if you think about an embedded Linux device, you have a few components. You're gonna have at least three components: the bootloader, the kernel Linux, and the root file system. So every device should be checked during boot, right? If you just check the rootfs, the root file system, you're gonna have problems, right? Because if you change the one who checked the root file system, you can change the root file system. So you have to check all of the components. And the way it works is that one component check the other. So bootloader will check the kernel, and the kernel will check the root file system. One trust in the other. So that's why we call chain of trust, right? One component will trust on the other component during the boot process. So this is a diagram of how would work a secure boot process. When you power up a device, what runs? It depends on the device, it depends on the hardware. Usually, for example, on a system on chip ARM device, what is going to run, it's a ROM code. It's a code inside the SoC. And that code will check the bootloader. So how does this check work? Every image, bootloader, kernel, which file system is signed, right? So every image is signed with a private key. And to check that signature, the component that is going to check is going to have the public key. So how does it work? Inside the SoC, we're going to have a logic for that, right? So for example, I'm going to show in a few slides how this works on IMX6 from NXP. We have a hardware component inside the SoC called Hub, High Assurance Boot. It has all the logic to check the signature of the bootloader before booting it. So what you're going to have to do is to store the public key inside the SoC. So inside the SoC, we're going to have some one-time programming fuses. You're going to save the public key there. Actually, you don't save the public key because the public key is too long. So actually what is done is that we create, we generate a hash of the public key, and that hash is saved inside the ROM code of the device. So during boot, the ROM code will load the certificate of the bootloader, will check the signature, basically decrypting the hash, comparing the hash with the hash of the bootloader. If the same, good, let's boot it. The bootloader boots, and the bootloader will have a public key related to the private key that was used to sign the kernel. Then the bootloader will check the signature of the kernel using the private key, the public key, and then the kernel boots. Here we're going to see that the kernel is not able to check the signature of the root file system, so the kernel will boot a run disk to do that. And then the run disk will use a public key to check the signature of the root file system. So as you can see in this diagram, it's a chain of trust, right? So we have a chain of execution, and then the bootloader will trust in the ROM code, and the kernel will trust in the bootloader, and the thing goes until the end, until the root file system starts and the init process runs. How does it work on the IMX6? I will skip these two slides because I'm going to explain all of this in this diagram. So this is that same image, but with more detail, right? And focus on the IMX6 implementation. So inside the IMX6, we have a piece of hardware called HAB, H-A-B, Hardware High Assurance Boot. It's all the logic to read the certificate of the bootloader, check the signature, and boot if the signature matches. So you're going to have to store the hash of the public key inside the OTP fuses of the IMX6, and is going to use these hashes to check the signature of U-boot. And then U-boot is going to check the signature of the Linux kernel. Actually, we have here the Linux kernel, we have device trees, right? And we are going to have also a hand disk to check the signature of the bootloader. So usually, to implement a secure boot in Linux, we use a kind of container image called fit image. A fit image is basically a container image of images. So inside the fit image, we have images with hashes and signatures. So every image here is hashed and signed with a private key. And then you're gonna have to add the public key inside your boot. So your boot will be able to load the fit image, identify the images, check the signature of each of the images inside the fit image, and then boot the Linux kernel. After that, after the Linux kernel boots, it's going to start the run disk in the init process of the hand disk, and then the hand disk will check the signature of the rootfs. And for that, we have some options. In this example here, I'm showing how would work using dmVarit, but we have other options also. dmVarit is a kernel module. It was created by the guys from Google to implement a secure boot on Android. So Android uses the dmVarit for that. Basically, what dmVarit does is create a tree of hashes. So it takes all of the blocks of your root file system and hash all of them. So it creates a lot of hashes, right? And then after that, it takes two hashes and creates one hash based on that hash. And then for every two hashes, you have one hash. And then it goes over, takes another two hashes, it creates one hash. So as you can see, you have a tree of hashes until we have the root hash. And then the root hash is signed and it stays in this metadata partition. And during boot, Handisk will use a public key to verify the signature of this root hash. And that's how it works using the dmVarit. There is, of course, some trade-offs here because the dmVarit is very fast, but it only supports a read-only file system. If you want to have integrity support on a read-write file system, you're going to have to use another option. And I know two options, the IMA or the DM integrity. Two other options to improve the security of the system, check the integrity of a file system. Usually, I recommend having a read-only root file system, and for that, would be good to have to use dmVarit because it's real fast on a read-only file system. So basically, of course, we could get into more details on that, right? But we're gonna uncover here a lot of other technologies, so we don't have much time for that. But that's basically the idea of a secure boot process, right? And it's a chain of trust where one component depends and trusts on the other company. And the first component we call root of trust. So the root of trust of this secure boot process is the code inside the SoC. Yeah, and that's a problem, right? Because if the root of trust is not trustable, we could have problems. And almost 3 years ago, vulnerabilities were found inside the wrong code of some of the IMX family of NXP. So basically, they found that if you provide a certificate, a specific certificate, you could just crash the code running inside the ROM of the IMX and bypass the secure boot. Yeah, if you are interested in this, you could read these two links here. I was told that you're going to receive next week an email with the recorded, with this talk recorded, and also the slides. So you're gonna have access to these slides, and you're gonna be able to go through all of the links that I have here, okay? About this vulnerability, NXP fixed it in an old silicon, right? But you have an old silicon, you could still have this vulnerability inside the SoC. Right, we talked a lot about secure boot, and secure boot ensures authenticity and the integrity of the codes. But what about you want to prevent someone from extract the code of our device? The secure boot process won't prevent that. Right. If you want to protect the code, like you have intellectual property inside the device, something that you don't want your someone to copy, it could be also data, right? You want to guarantee the privacy of the user data, so you don't want anyone to mess with the data of the device. Then you're gonna have to use encryption. And I'm going to talk a little bit here about encryption. encrypting the code is not very common, I would say. It's really not common on an embedded Linux device because of, I would say, a couple of things. Like, we are mostly running open source software, so we don't have much to hide. And the cost to encrypt all the system is high, so I wouldn't say it's good to encrypt everything, because you are not developing an operating system from scratch. You are using several open source components. The other problem with encrypting code is that if you are using any GPL v3 software, you can't encrypt. You can't, because GPL v3 says that you have to provide to your user a way to update the software on the device. So if you encrypt it, the user don't have that option. So of course you could try to avoid GPL v3. But what I would say is that if you want to encrypt your application, maybe the best approach is to create another partition and run your application from that partition and leave the root file system open, because it's mostly open source software. You're gonna have to provide the licenses and source code of all of that. So the costs of doing that too high to care about. But if you want to protect your application on a specific partition or user data, and that's important, you're gonna have to think about encryption. We have basically two approaches to encryption in Linux. We have a full disk encryption or a file-based or a directory-based encryption. Full disk encryption partition, to implement it, we could use the dmcrypt kernel module. Basically, it's a kernel module that sits on top of a file system, and every access to the file system, we get to the dmcrypt that will, at runtime, encrypt and decrypt the files in the file system. So you could use the dmcrypt on top of any file system, because it works at the file, at the block level, not at the file system level. Another approach to encryption in Linux is at the file system level. So this one will sit on top of the file system level, not on the block level. And then we could use fscrypt. That's basically an API that some file systems provide. So if, for example, you are using X4, you could use fscrypt to encrypt, for example, a directory inside your partition. If you want to go more generic, like and have an encryption system for any kind of file system, you could use the encryptfs. This is the same diagram with secure boot. Now I'm including the protection with encryption. So it's the same diagram, the same process, but in the end, when the rootfs is verified and boots, it will mount the data partition using, in this example, encryptfs. Of course, this is just an example. We could do that in the run disk also, but here I'm doing in the root file system. But here we have a problem. The problem is that when we talk about secure boot, we're talking about checking signatures, right? And to check a signature, we just need a public key, because the image is signed with a private key. And the public key, as the name implies, is public. You can store, everyone can knows about the keys. This is not a problem. But the encryption, we don't use an asymmetric or a public key encryption on a public key algorithm on encryption, because it's too slow. Right, so an asymmetric algorithm to do encryption is too slow. We don't use on encryption. On encryption, we usually use a symmetric algorithm. And asymmetric algorithm means that you have just one key to encrypt and decrypt. And what is the problem here? Where should you store this key, right? Because you have to have the key somewhere in your product to decrypt the data partition in this example. where would you save this key? Well, this is the image. I don't know if anyone from the audience has already read Hacking the Xbox book. It's a very good book for those who like hardware hacking. This is a picture from the original Xbox. And looks like Microsoft didn't care much about the key when they designed the first Xbox. The key was there, sitting side by side with the firmware. So Bunny, that the one who hacked the first Xbox and wrote this book. This book is free. Everyone can download and read. It's a very good book on hardware hacking. He developed a board, an FPGA-based board, to sniff the bus between the CPU and I think the North Bridge or South Bridge. But he's just sniffing the birds, logging everything, and then he developed a tool to search for the key, and he found it. He found the key to encrypt and decrypt code inside the Xbox, and he published a paper. So if anyone is interested in this work, the Hacking the Xbox is a very good book on this topic. Yeah, that means we shouldn't store the key there. Clear text with the code, right? It should be stored in a secure place, right? If we are developing a system that has some interaction with the user, we could use an algorithm that could derive a key from a passphrase. So you like type a password or a kind of pattern, it will decrypt the key with that pattern. That could be done. That's exactly how Android does. But most of the embedded Linux systems don't have interaction, right? Like every boot should go there to type a password so the system would decrypt the data partition. That doesn't happen on an embedded Linux system. So you're going to have to store the key somewhere. You could use some feature of your SoC. So for example, the IMAX has a hardware module inside called its Cryptographic Accelerator and Assurance Module, CAM. And this module provides a lot of security features, and it has a master key. Then you could use this module to encrypt your key. And then you could save your key in your file system, but encrypt it. Use the key inside this cryptographic module. That could be one solution. If you are using an IMAX device, that would be enough to have a key stored in your system securely. If you don't have that kind of feature inside the SoC, you would probably have to use another piece of hardware for that. And then we could use a secure element or a TPM device. I'm going to talk a little bit about both in the next two slides. The third option would be to use a trusted execution environment. I'm going to also talk about trusted execution environment in a few slides. So one option to store a key in a safe way is to use a secure element. A secure element is basically a computing system that provides a secure storage, and it makes it possible to run secure applications. Usually, we create Java card applications for a secure element, but could be any kind of application. It depends on how the secure element is implemented, because we don't have really a standard for secure elements. You could do anything you want. Two common examples of secure elements are SIM cards. The SIM card that you have on your smartphone is a secure element. Smart cards that you could, for example, plug on your PC to authenticate some operation. A smart card is also a secure element. Usually, the drivers for the secure elements implement an API called the Public Key Cryptographic Standard, PKCS 11. And this this is a standard. This is a standard API. And a lot of libraries and tools in Linux support this standard. So for example, if you have a secure element connected to your device and you have a driver compatible with PKCS 11, you could, for example, use OpenSSL or libssl to execute security operations like generating keys or signing data using the secure element. So this is one option. Another option to secure keys on your device is using a TPM device. A TPM device is a little bit different from a secure element, right? Because TPM is basically a specification. It's not really a device, but we have devices that implement this specification. So it's an ISO specification, and it is a specification that means it is already defined what it does, right? All of the operations, all of the algorithms that supports. Although the version 2, you could have your own algorithms implemented, but the specification defines how you should do it, right? It's different from the secure element where you could do anything you want inside of it. The TPM is more standardized. That's another solution. You could have a TPM device, TPM chip on your device to store and manage keys and possibly sign and check signatures using this key, for example. Yeah, usually the TPM device has a friendly interface like I2C or SPI to the system. Very good. So now we have talked a lot about some mitigations to security problems in Linux, like secure boot, encryption, how to store keys, but none of this matter if your application is buggy, right? Because when your code is running and your application is buggy and it is exploitable, none of this matter. Someone could attack your application. For example, your application has a buffer overflow problem. Someone could attack your application and run unintended code inside of it. You have to mitigate that risk, right? This is just an example, but you can find a lot of examples. And usually we said that for each 1,000 lines of code, you have one bug. So if we have millions and millions of lines of code inside the Linux kernel, how much bugs do you have there? A lot of bugs. This is one bug. As you can see, more than 10 years, we have this bug, a buffer overflow bug inside the Linux kernel. It was fixed last year. And you could exploit and do anything with it, right? So it's a bug. Yeah. How do we mitigate that kind of bugs to improve the security? First, I would say, use always static analysis tools. Run static analysis tools on your code to find bugs. That's very important, especially for applications that are running, are implemented in memory unsafe languages like C and C++, right? So we have a lot of good open source tools. I would say CPP check is one good tool. Clang is also very good. I would say compile your code with Clang because the static analysis code from Clang is very good. There are also some commercial tools. Covert, for example, is a very good example of a commercial tool that would check our code. And the idea is exactly that. Before you compile your code, check your code with static analysis tools. You would find a lot of bugs that you even know it exists. After that, I would say protect your code. Enable protections at runtime to check if what your code is doing is the right thing to do, right? So for example, Google created this tool called Address Sanitizer that's available on GCC and Clang. That would, at runtime, check memory access. So we could prevent a lot of memory access bugs, like null pointer, the references, out of bound access. It's a very good tool. The overhead is minimal. That's what I like about this tool, because you could even leave it enabled in production, because the overhead is really, really minimal. It's a very good tool. That's one way to mitigate, right, the bugs that we could have on memory unsafe programs. Another tool that we could use is called address space layout randomization. Actually, this is basically a way to compile your code, because when you compile your code, for example, when you compile the kernel Linux, the Linux kernel, all the address is going to be the same. So when you boot a kernel, you're going to have always the same address. So if you have a crash in the kernel, the crash will happen always in the same address. It is what the attacker wants, because it's very easy to develop an exploit if you know which addresses are the functions, for example, right? So if you randomize the addresses, it's going to make much more difficult for the attacker to attack the system, much more difficult. It's not impossible, of course, but it's much more difficult. So if you enable the address space layout randomization in the Linux kernel, and there is an option for that, that's another layer of security in your system. And we have also fuzzing tools. A fuzzing tool is basically a test tool. A fuzzing tool helps improve the quality of your program, because the fuzzing tool is able to generate inputs to your application that could test some parts of the code that you usually don't test. And for example, generate crashes, that is a way for the attacker to exploit your system. So there are some good fuzzing tools that you could try. That's one of the main tools that the attacker uses to find vulnerabilities in software. And for example, this Syscaller, that's a kernel fuzzer. Syscaller has already found thousands of bugs in the Linux kernel, just fuzzing the Linux kernel, fuzzing system calls, things like that. So it's a very good way to improve the security of the system, is to use a fuzzing tool to test the system. As you can see here, we have layers on top of layers, right? And that's really what security means. Nothing that matters, or you could use the static analysis tools, you could improve with runtime checks, but your application will always have bugs. That's always going to happen. So how do we mitigate that? If you have a bug, how do we mitigate that? Because if you run an application, for example, with root access and you have a bug, the attacker would have root access, could elevate privileges. So how would you prevent that? Don't run your application as root, right? That's one good design decision. Don't ever, or try to not run your application as root. Always design with the principle of less privilege. What do you need? Why do you need root to do that? There are some times, I would say, that you could need root access. For example, you want to send raw packets to the network interface. And then only root actually can do that on Linux. How would you manage that? Run an application as root just because you have to send raw sockets, for example, ICMP sockets. You're gonna have to run an application as root, but you could use capabilities. Capabilities is a feature of the Linux kernel that you could use to drop the privileges of a root application. So you could configure your application to use just the capability it needs to do its work. So for example, in some implementations of the ping command, you would see that if you run the getcap command on the application, it would return all the capabilities that the application has. And in this example here, it is returning that this implementation of ping only has these capabilities to send raw net packets. So it is running as root, but it can do what root do, only send the raw network packages. And that's a good measure to drop the privileges of an application that is running as root. Better yet, if you can use a Mac implementation. This is another way to view permissions on the Linux system. Usually we view permissions as user, group, and files, right? So which process has access to which file based on its username and its group. But this is not so flexible. For example, what if you want an application to just open TCP port 8? How would you prevent an application to open another TCP port? You basically can do that with permissions, right? But you could use the MAC control access for that. So MAC stands for mandatory access control. The idea of the MAC system is a little bit different. So you would define the objects of your system, and object could be anything. Could be write to a specific file, read from a specific device, open a specific TCP port. You would define the objects, and you would define which subjects will have access to some objects. We could have a full webinar only on this topic, right? Because it's a very complicated topic, I would say. Two implementations of MAC are SELinux and AppArmor. So if you are interested, I would say take a look at SELinux or AppArmor. SELinux is very popular. It is used on Android and Fedora. AppArmor is also very popular. It is used on Debian, for example, and Ubuntu. So if you want to improve the permissions of the system, I would say, yeah, take a look at a MAC implementation and see if it could help you on the design of your product. Another way to mitigate problems in the application is sandboxing the application. So what would you do? Take your application, put it in the sandbox, and run it there, isolated from the rest of the system. There is a very old tool in Linux called shroot, right? It would do basically that, but the chroot would just isolate the file system. It doesn't isolate the application. What means isolate the application? The application only sees itself, nothing else more. So all of the other process, it doesn't have access. So it really runs isolated from other process, other mount points, other file systems. It runs really isolated. Virtualization is one way to sandbox an application. So we run a full operating system isolated. You could, for example, use QEMU for that, but it's really heavy, right, to like run your application inside QEMU with the whole kernel for this. So it doesn't make much sense on an embedded Linux system. I would say nowadays we have basically two ways to isolate and sandbox an application: using containers or running the application on a trusted execution environment. So container is a very good and easy, I would say, way to isolate your application. The idea here is to use some features from the kernel, like namespace, C group, seccomp, some other features to really isolate your application. So your application is going to run inside the container. The application will not have a view of the system. It's not going to see all the other process, all the other file systems, all the other network connections. It's not going to see anything. It's going to really be isolated from the rest of the system. So this is basically the idea, right? You have your operating system and your applications run inside the container. So if your application have a bug and the bug is exploited, what the attacker could do? He could exploit that container, right? But not the whole system. The whole system would still be protected. So see, that's another layer of protection, right? Because if an attacker could exploit the application running in the operating system, it could exploit everything. But inside the container, it is really isolated. Some people say that container provides security, but that's not really true, because you have to think about the security when you use containers. Not just that container is secure, no, but if you think about security when you run your container and you configure it well, it will be another layer of security on your system. The second way to run your application isolated from the rest of the system is using a trusted execution environment. And that's a very different implementation, right? Because what a container doesn't do, if your kernel is exploited, you lose everything, right? Because you can't prevent that. So you have bugs in your kernel. How would you prevent from that bug in your kernel have access to your assets? A trusted execution environment would prevent that, because you would have another execution environment to run your secure applications, to store your data, for example. And nowadays, a lot of embedded devices uses a trusted execution environment. For example, a smart TV, our smartphone, Android uses a lot the trusted execution environment, set-top box from cable TVs, and the list goes on and on. We could use a trusted execution environment to store keys, to run trusted code, to do what we want to do isolated from the rest of the system. We usually call the operating system the rich execution environment. For example, Linux, that's our case, right? So we have here Linux kernel managing the untrusted applications. And when we want to access an asset, be code or data in the trusted execution environment, we would make calls to the trusted execution environment to do that. And this is really running isolated from the rest of the system. It has protected hardware, protected, like part of the memory is protected, part of the devices could be protected. As you can see, we need hardware support for that, right? So to implement a trusted execution environment, we need support in the hardware. Some of you may have heard of the trust zone from ARM. We have also multi-zone from RISC-V and other implementations. This is all to implement that kind of environment. So in the case of trusted execution environment on ARM, we would use the trust zone features to isolate the system from the rest of the operating system. And here we could safely, for example, store keys. Yeah, because it's not accessible, at least from a software point of view, right? I'm not talking about it, the hardware point of view, because it's somewhere in flash. Someone could open the device, extract the flash and the firmware with the keys. So you won't store the keys here in clear text. You would probably, if you want to protect in the hardware level, you will want to encrypt your keys. But from a software point of view, is really protected. Of course, I'm not considering here that you have bugs in the Trust OS, right? Because if you have bugs in Trust OS, your security doesn't exist. There is some implementations of trusted execution environments. I would say some no implementations. Kinibi from Samsung. So if you have a Galaxy S device, you are running Kinibi on your device. There are trusty from Google. If you are using a Pixel device, you are running trusty on your device. There is an open source implementation, OptE. Nowadays, Linaro is taking care of this implementation. So it's open source. You could port to your device if you want. Okay, we talk a lot about mitigations, right? But bugs will always happen. We will always have bugs. And how do we manage bugs? We update the system. So we really, if we are developing a product with a security in mind, we really need a good update system in place. We really need. When you think about update systems, we have to think about a lot of things, right? And sometimes there is trade-offs between like the security and the bandwidth and the atomic key. But we have to think about it. So there are some challenges to implement a good update system. That's why we usually don't roll our own update system. We usually use an update system that is already implemented and tested. It's good to know a little bit about the way to update the system. We could update just the application, but this is really not maintainable because we lose track of the version of our system. We could have an update based on packages. So you update packages of your system. I wouldn't recommend that because sometimes you also lose tracks of what you're running in the field. Sometimes you break dependencies and you just break your system. You have to reinstall it. So it's really not a good option for an embedded device. I would say we have two good options for embedded device. An image-based update system where you would update the whole image of the system. You could, for example, have two root file system partitions. You run from one partition, and if you want to update, you write to the other partition. When you finish the update, you reboot your system in the other partition, and the system is updated. This is a very good way to update the system because you could also roll back the system if the update doesn't work right, because you also have the old partition. So if you have storage enough to do that, and if you have bandwidth enough, because you're gonna have to download all of your system to update it, right? You could implement an image-based update system. You could have some similar using a container-based update system. You could just have your applications running inside the container and update just the container. So the container image is much more, is not as big as an image, the full image, right? So you will use less network during the update. And you could also have that feature of atomicity that an image-based system could bring you. You could, for example, store the old container. You could try to run the new container. If it doesn't run, get back to the old container. So if you do it in the right way, you could have all the advantages of an image-based update system, but using less storage and less bandwidth of the connection. Again, we could have a whole presentation on update systems, right? And that's not the objective here. I just want to point it out that the update system is very important for the security of the system. And the last thing I want to talk about to finish here the presentation, go to the question and answers, is network security. We could have another presentation on network security, and that's another point here, but I want to point out some bullet points on how to improve the security of a device that's connected in the network, right? And you're gonna have to think about it. So close all ports that you're not using, disable all protocols that you're not using, like if you don't need IPv6, disable it. If you don't need PPP, disable it. Just leave it open what you're using. Just leave it enabled what you're going to need to use it. Here, what we're doing is decreasing the attack surface, right? So more protocols, more attack surfaces. So let's decrease the attack surface. Create file rules, try to prevent connections inbound or outbound. If you are worried about denial of service attacks, you could create file rules to try to prevent that. If you really worry about someone getting access to your device, you could, for example, use an IDS system, intrusion detection system, to identify patterns in the network connection that could be related to an attack from the network. Always use a secure connection with external devices. If you need to connect to the clouds, of course, use a VPN or SSH. Use a secure connection and try to rate limit logins. So for example, you are using a service to connect to your device, configure the service with rate limit. Like if the user type the password wrong 3 times, just stop the service for an amount of time. This would prevent brute force attacks on your device. There are some small tips that could improve a lot the security of your device if it is connected to the network. And as you can see here, there's no silver bullet, right? We have talked a lot about mitigations, and I think we cover most of the mitigations we have on an embedded Linux device, right? From secure boot to encrypting your device, to securing your application, to mitigate risks of being exploited, static analysis tools, fuzzing, runtime checks, run inside a container, store keys in a secure way. So yeah, there is no silver bullet on security. As you can see, all of the levels of this, you have to take care of all of the levels of the system, right? If you are worried about the hardware, you have to protect the hardware. And I'm really not focusing here on hardware, but I could talk about what you should do with the console of our device, with the JTAG of our device. So, but we are not worrying about this here, only the softer part of the system. But you could, or you should think about it, right? The hardware, the software, the connections, the cloud, if we're connecting to the cloud, it's really a defense in depth. You add a layer on top of layer to secure your device. You have also to think about the least privilege principle. So an application should only have access to what it needs to do, to what's required to do its job. Try to prevent obscurity or obfuscation. Sometimes I see companies like implementing his own algorithms, his own hash algorithms, or his own encryption algorithms, thinking, oh, no one knows these algorithms, so no one's going to break. That's really not true. It's very easy to break this kind of algorithm. So don't do that. Don't reinvent the wheel. Use what is there. And yeah, that's the sad thing, right? There is no 100% secure system. We will always have some kind of vulnerability. And we just try to mitigate, right, and make it very, very hard for the attacker to exploit the vulnerabilities that we could possibly have in the system. Always design with the security in mind. Think about the trade-offs, and that's important, right? Because there is really a trade-off between the security and the friendliness of the device. Usually more secure, less friendly the device is to the user. And sometimes also to the developer, makes it harder to develop on the device. And you have to take this into account when improving the security of the device. Try to follow good security practices, use techniques, tools, what we saw here, and have an update system. That's very important. Not only have the update system, but plan how you're going to do the update, right? Monitor the security vulnerabilities, the patches, apply patches to your system. This is also very important if security is an important feature of your product. Here at Toradex, we are developing Torizon. That's our offer to our customers to make it very easy to work on an embedded Linux platform. And of course, we try to follow good practices to develop this product. And we try to identify a good balance between the ease of use of the product and the security of the product. So two qualities of Torizon that's related to security is containers, right? Torizon is basically a distribution that run containers for you. And as I said, containers per se is not secure, but if configure a container in a secure way, it will improve the security of the system. And We have also an update system in place for Toradex. So that's another feature of Toradex that helps Toradex customers to improve the security of the products. So I really hope you enjoyed this presentation. I try to cover here a lot of different topics on how to improve the embedded, the security of an embedded Linux system. It's really, we could have a lot of presentations on this topic, right? A presentation on secure boot, a presentation on secure modules. So yeah, it's a very broad topic. I try to bring here a kind of general view of what we have to improve the security of embedded Linux systems. So now I'm gonna switch to some questions. I have here some questions, so I don't know if I'm gonna be able to answer to all of the questions because we just ran out of time, but all of your questions is going to be answered. If not now, by me, you're gonna have to receive an email and your question will be answered. So let's start here. Is there an alternate way of ensuring authenticity on embedded firmware than checking the certificate of the public key? Certificate usually expires. Yeah, you have to think about that. If you remember when I was talking about the trade-offs of a secure boot, right? One of the things that you have to worry about is the management and the provisioning of the keys. And yeah, the certificates could expire and you have to think about how to update them. For example, on how this is handled inside the IMX6 HAP feature. You can store not only one hash of the public key, you can store, as far as I remember, on IMX6, four different hashes. So if one of them is expired, he could use another. So you could have, like you could define four different private keys, and he could use one of these keys to check. But yeah, usually we use certificates because it's much faster. But yeah, you're gonna have to think about this problem when you develop your system. Let's go here to another question. How much longer would you expect a secure boot to take over a non-secure boot? Yeah, that's a very difficult question because it depends on the system. I have some experience. For example, I implemented a secure boot on a point of sale device, and I realized that it was around 30% slower than the device booting without the secure boot process. So yeah, it was a little bit slower, but for that device, the boot time wasn't very important. So we didn't care about that, but sometimes you have to care about that. But yeah, but expect a little bit slower system to boot. All IMX6 Toradex M6 modules have secboot capabilities. Yes, this is a feature of the IMX6. So if you are using a module with the IMX6, you're gonna have all of these features that I mentioned here, the HAP and the CAM, for example, the cryptographic module. Yeah, you're gonna have it. Let's go to the last question because we are really out of time. Because of OTP public key one hash, does secure boot mean you can never update the bootloader, kernel, etc.? Let's get back to that slide. So I think it would be better to explain. Here we go. Yeah, so the question is, you have the public key here. That means you can never update this. No, you can't update because you have the private key to sign your new image. So since you have the private key, you just sign the new image with that private key. You don't need to change it, right? And the IMX6 will use the public key to check the new image. Yeah, right. So you're going to have to change the U-boot image and also the signature inside the certificate. You have to update everything, right? But since you have the private key, you can do that. But an attacker, someone from outside, can do that because he or she doesn't have the private key to sign the new image. So it won't boot, right? But since you have the private key, you can do that. You can update any component of the system because you have the private key of the components, right? And you can update any of the images there. As I said during the presentation, you're going to receive an email with a recording of this presentation and the slides, right? Feel free to write to us. I hope you enjoyed this presentation and see you next time. Bye-bye.